Welcome, everyone. It's Thursday, and we are live. I've always wanted to use the Brent Musburger intro, although I don't know if it has the same oomph when you're live from your living room or your dining room or your home office. But anyway, we are live. It's Thursday, and this is the HockeyDebates.com podcast. I'm Bob Duff, as always, joined by my co-host, the esteemed Hall of Fame writer, Kevin Allen. And today, we're happy to welcome in as our special guest, Ansar Khan of MLive.com. He's the senior writer of terms of coverage, the Red Wings. He's been on that beat before they were good the last time. So he's seen the bad team go to become the great team and now back to the horrible team. So I don't know about you, Ansar. Being a Canadian, I guess there's a little more excitement about this return to play and that, but it seems I just can't seem to get excited about it. What do you sense is kind of the atmosphere in Michigan, you know, with the Red Wings not even being a part of this? Is there a buzz about hockey being back, or do people just not care?
Yeah, no, I don't sense any buzz whatsoever. I mean, and it's not surprising. I just think that even in years where the Red Wings made the playoffs but lost in the first round, I think after that the excitement of the Stanley Cup playoffs fades in Detroit. I think this is a Red Wing town more than it is a hockey town. I don't think people really care about the rest of the league that much. I mean, this isn't like the NFL where there's, you know, even when the Lions, even though the Lions have been bad for so long, the NFL is so huge. NHL, it's not the same. It's if the Red Wings aren't in it, if they're not doing well, I just don't, I don't see much of a buzz.
And so I think there is a buzz about the draft. I think, as we all know, the fans were upset that the Red Wings ended up with the number four pick. But now as we've moved past that, I've seen a lot of discussion on social media about who they should take. I'm going to ask you to embrace an impossible task of getting inside Steve Yzerman's head. And when you get to that number four pick, presuming that the top three forwards that we've been talking about forever are all gone, where does Steve Yzerman go? Does he go to Drysdale? Does he go to Rossi? Where do you think he goes?
Yeah, it's certainly, like you said, number four was it was bad in so many ways, especially since there's really that divide, that division between the first three and then the next wave. Like you said, the first three are, you know, predictable. Certainly, you know, Byfield and Stutzla could go two or three, I guess, in either order. But it would be very surprising if those two weren't two and three in some order. And then after that, the guessing game starts. I mean, you know, the Wings could go in any number of directions. And as Yzerman showed last year, I mean, it's difficult predicting what he's going to do. He gives no clues. Nobody in the organization gives clues, certainly. He might not even give any clues to them, for all we know. As we saw last year with the surprise pick of Seider. I wrote something a few weeks ago. I if it were me, I would take Drysdale. I would take the top available defenseman, you know, according to all the analysts. He's rated number one among D-men. And I think, you know, you've got to get Drysdale, you know, pair him up or have him with Seider kind of coming up together almost, really boost your back end. And I think that's what they're in need of more so than, you know, a forward who isn't in the same class as, say, a Lafreniere would have been obviously the obvious pick for anybody at number one. But I would go with the top defenseman at number four. Whether he does it or not, I couldn't tell you. I wouldn't. Who knows? I wouldn't be surprised if it was like a Perfetti or Rossi or Lucas Raymond. Somebody emailed me the other day about making an impassioned case for Askarov.
Yeah.
You know, saying, you know, he can be the Wings goalie for the next, you know, 12, 15 years or whatever, something that they need. And you know, I pointed out that, you know, it's very rare, as you know, for goalies to go that high. And it does seem like over the last year, it seemed like maybe it's just my imagination. Have you noticed he's kind of fallen a little bit in
oh, 19, yeah, for sure.
In mock draft? There was much more buzz about him like a year ago than there is now. I don't know if it was the World Junior performance or season or what, but he seems to have gone a few notches down. I just think that's too high to take him at number four, especially, you know, for a goalie who's, you know, it's not that the Wings expect to be certainly on playoff contention next year or any kind of contention for the next few years, but, you know, he's not going to help you for several years, and there's always that unpredictability about goalies, about you know, how they'll pan out. So, I would be surprised if they took him at number four. My guess right now would be Drysdale.
You think Yzerman would ever entertain the notion of trading down if you get a piece that could help the team, and then taking Askarov maybe at 9 or 10?
I think he would certainly consider it. But I don't know if anybody would. You think anybody would want to go up to number four? I mean, there's nobody compelling to say, okay, I'll give you a pretty good asset to get. Who at number four would be that compelling to want it, to make a team want to give up a good asset to get there?
That's a good point, Ansar. I think also the Red Wing fans, you know, I think have a lot of interest in projecting what the roster will look like whenever we play next season, not this season, because obviously, you know, the Red Wings are not part of the 24-team playoff format. And I, you know, there's to me at least two or three questions that have to be asked and answered before you can sort of say what will happen. And the three questions I would say is, is Joe Valeno ready and can he score? Is Rasmussen capable of playing in the top six? And is there any hope that Yzerman can move any of those veteran salaries that are sort of in the way for young players to come up, in particular like Franz Nielsen and Justin Abdicator?
Well, for the last question there, I don't see any way of moving those two players that you mentioned. I think with Abdicator, of course, we don't know what the situation is going to be like with the AHL and all that, and just how things are going to pan out. But under normal circumstances, certainly I think there would be a good chance where Abdicator, unless he improves significantly, shows much more in training camp in the preseason, that he could be waived before the start of the season and sent to Grand Rapids. I could see that happening. Of course, like, I don't know. We don't know what, like I said, what the situation is going to be like in that regard with the AHL and all that. But certainly his spot, I think, is precarious. With Franz Nielsen, you know, I can envision Franz Nielsen being like a part-time player in the lineup. Some of the time, healthy scratch. Some of the time, something along those lines. But I believe Nielsen's got 2 years left on his contract. I just don't think an Abdicator with 3 years left. There's just I just don't see any way of being able to move that. I mean, for a team to even certainly the Wings would have to absorb a lot of the salary, which. Really, what's the point when you can just remove them from your lineup? I think, and then your other question was about Valeno and Rasmussen. I don't see Valeno making the team. I think he needs another year of development in Grand Rapids. I think he needs to be a much more important player, a much more dominant player at the AHL level. But then, of course, again, we got the whole uncertainty about the AHL next year. But I don't see him being good enough to crack this lineup. Certainly not in a in a top or nine role as a number three center. I think Rasmussen I would envision as a number three center. You know, he's had that year in Grand Rapids, or most of it, due to the injuries, which was needed for him. I would expect him to make the team and be that number three center, but not. I think Valeno will need some more development wherever that may be.
Just a quick follow up. I wonder if you had heard anything, any speculation or any theories around the Red Wings regarding what happened to Franz Nielsen. Like, he was a really effective quality player for the New York Islanders. Like, he was an important, vital player. You know, he was so important to that team and all aspects of their game, you know. And he's come to Detroit, and he's not nearly the same player. And it can't be just age. He's just really just fallen right off the map.
Yeah, no, I haven't. I suspected it was most of it I would attribute to age and just a natural deterioration of his game. And I think also, you know, just the team that he's, the players that he's surrounded by, not as much skill, that certainly plays into it. You know, he's had a couple of injuries, and it just seems like a lot of times when it goes fast. You know, you could be going along at a pretty decent rate, and then the next thing you know, the wheels come off pretty quick in this game, it seems like, and it seems like that's what happened with Franz Nielsen.
Now, on the weekend, they leveled the Palace of Auburn Hills. Now, we associate that Palace with the Detroit Pistons, but there was a lot of hockey played there. You know, I was there the night they had the celebration when the Detroit Vipers won the Turner Cup, and I remember the captain Bradshaw having this impassioned plea to all the players because they'd had quite a raucous party the night before and did some serious damage to the Turner Cup, and was basically being held together with hockey tape. And Shaw begged the players, whatever you do tonight, don't lift it over your head because it's going to fall apart. But, you know, there was that. There was the Detroit Whalers when they, before they became the Plymouth Whalers, when they kind of got evicted at the last minute right from the start of the season, when Peter Carmano and Mike Ilitch, another one of their feuds, and they sought refuge for a season in the Palace. So I joked with someone, you know, the implosion of the leveling of the Palace is going to have a hard time getting on the podium this year in terms of Detroit sports implosions, because there's been so many bad things happen in this city. But do you have a favorite Palace memory, Ansar?
I never covered the Vipers there. I did cover a little bit of the Pistons, like as a fill-in backup role during the regular season, a few games here and there, and during a few of their championship playoff runs. You know, one thing that comes to mind was I was there. I was sitting pretty close behind the Pistons bench, or no, it would have been the Bulls bench, actually, in the famous walk-off game in 91 when the Bulls swept them in game four. And I remember the walk-off, and I remember before that, I think it was in the last minute, as they were losing, Chuck Daly turning to one of his assistants, I can't remember which assistant, Brendan Sir or Brendan Malone, and just smiling and shaking his hand and just saying something along the lines, well, we had a great run. We had a great run, just as it was ending there. And then, of course, the infamous walk-off, which no doubt cost Isaiah Thomas a spot on the Dream Team. That stands out. I remember actually game five against San Antonio, the big shot Bob game where Rasheed Wallace left them open there. Mm-hmm. One of the things that stands out was where I was sitting, Eva Longoria who was married to Tony Parker at the time, she was sitting like behind me and just screaming the entire game, everything that, you know, cheering for Parker and everything. And I just, it was just annoying as hell. I couldn't take it anymore. Just her voice was so screechy. And for some reason that stands out to me too, as a memory of the Palace.
We're almost out of time, Ansar, but real quick here, I want to ask you, I just feel like, and I've not heard this through the grapevine or anything, but there's a lot of goalies available out there this whenever we have the free agent signing period, and also in trade as well. You know, the Penguins have said openly they might trade one of their younger goalies. Jake Allen will be available, and he's kind of sort of renovated his career. There are also some goalies that are veteran goalies out there, Crawford, Robin Leonard. And I just wonder whether Steve Yzerman will be tempted to go out and get a goalie that, you know, can be with this team for a few years, but even now can give them a little more confidence as a young team. Just, you know, just get someone who's solid and dependable, or a guy like Murray or Jerry from Pittsburgh, and let him be the guy for the future. What are your thoughts? Do you think there's any chance they'll go out and try to get one of those goalies?
Yeah, I think so. I think that's a possibility. Certainly, the handful of free agents, if any of those don't appeal to them, certainly they've got some assets. They've got, what, 3 second-round picks, 2 third-round picks. So they've got something to work with there. I think he would be certainly willing to give up some of that draft capital to get a proven goalie in here. And and the other thing too is, what about some of these teams that might run into protection problem with the goalie for the expansion draft, kind of like Pittsburgh did with Fleury? You know, there could be an opportunity there too as well to make a trade for a goalie.
All right. Well, we want to thank you for joining us today, Ansar. And if you can remember what it's like to cover a hockey game, hopefully you'll remember how to do it when you eventually get to cover a Wings game. It's going to be a while.
Still a long way to go, and a lot of days to come up with content, which is increasingly difficult.
Yeah.
Well, you go work on that and have a good day. And thanks for joining us.
Thanks, guys. Talk to you later.
Yeah. Thanks, Ansar.
Ansar is one of my favorite people. He's just so he's so deadpan with his humor. He can make him laugh.
Yeah. Well, for sure. And you know, when you were talking about his longevity too, I've long felt he's been one of the most underrated beat writers in the National Hockey League. You know, he doesn't get the notoriety that some of the other top beat writers get, but he's right there with them. I mean, he's. He's been a very solid beat writer for a long time. Like, he doesn't get beat on a story. He's always right there. There's a lot of trust and respect for him within the room, and I think with management. They know that he's kind of an old school guy, and I think they appreciate that.
Yeah, and he's a guy that never stops working and just always has his ear to the ground and has his finger on the pulse. And, I mean, as you noted, it's very difficult to do since Steve Yzerman moved in there because, you know, he keeps that operation locked up tighter than the CIA.
Yeah, that's for sure. When Ansar was talking about that, he thinks that within the organization, he's not even sure that they know what Yzerman is thinking. And I would bet on that. I would think that maybe the only two people who know what Yzerman's thinking about this draft coming up are Pat Verbeek and Chris Draper. I bet no one else knows. And, you know, the one thing I've noted about Steve Yzerman is that he has always kept played things close to the vest and keeps a very tight council around him. You know, he doesn't, you know, if you want to be Steve Yzerman's confidant, you got to be able to keep your trap shut at all times. And that's why I think not very many people. I think he's more Lou Lamoriello than Lou Lamoriello is. You know, people always talk about, you know, Lamoriello doesn't give anything up and doesn't tell people anything. I bet Lou tells more people than Steve does. I mean, that's just a guess because we'll never be able to prove it. But, you know, it might be a 3-2 score. But I think Eiserman might win that. I'm just
the public perception of the two. I don't think outside of New Jersey, really, anybody would have a lot of love for Lou Lamoriello. But yet, Eiserman is a beloved figure in the game. And yet,
no, that's fair. Although I would say that Lou Lamoriello is very, and a lot of people don't realize this, is very popular with players. Like, you ask anybody that played for Lou Lamoriello, and they all have a story about, you know, Lamoriello treating them well. I remember when Zach Parise packed up and left that team, and he did his press conference after going to Minnesota. He told about his goodbye conversation with Lou Lamoriello, and Lou Lamoriello wished him well, said he completely understood that Parise wanted to go home, and sometimes you got to follow your heart and all that kind of thing. Like, it was not a nasty conversation. And I've also had conversations with people who said that they always thought that Lamoriello treated them fairly in contract negotiations. Like, he was hard with the media a little bit and very secretive and buttoned up. But, I always felt he had a big heart. When I won the Elmer Ferguson Award from the Hall of Fame, I got a handwritten note. Who sends a handwritten note anymore? But Lou Lamoriello did. He sent me a handwritten note, congratulating me and talking about the fact that he and I started in the NHL about the same time, which is true. We both... It was right when he became general manager at the time, I became the beat writer for USA Today. So we had sort of spent the same, kind of time together. So, he's an interesting guy. He's a complicated guy. And I think that's the same thing we could say about Steve Eiserman. And, what's interesting about him is the contrasting styles of Steve Eiserman versus Ken Holland, who's a very good friend of his too. And that's another thing too. People say that, Holland must have been miffed to have Eiserman kind of waiting in the wings for his jobs. That is not true at all. Like, Holland and Eiserman are very good friends. Eiserman would have never have taken this job if Holland hadn't told him, I think it's time, which he did. He called Eiserman and said, I think it's time. The fans, there's unrest here and everything else. And they remain good friends. And Eiserman's a loyal guy. Holland treated him well for a lot of years. And but the other thing about Eiserman that I've always admired, and you'll remember this, a lot of guys, stars, superstars, think when they leave the game owes them a management position. They think that. And Eiserman wanted to work at it. Like, he basically almost accepted an apprenticeship under Ken Holland, where he basically worked with him, and he did everything you need to do to become an effective manager. He was in on contract negotiations. He did a lot of scouting. He was in on all the meetings and all that kind of stuff. He was really willing to put in the work to become a real effective guy and not just say, well, I'm Steve Eiserman, I'll just make that work and that'll be my calling card. Because, he might have been able to get away with that because, as you said, he's so popular, in Michigan. Maybe that would have been enough. But you ask around the league maybe the media, we get frustrated with him because, he's not a fountain of information. But you ask around the league, with agents and stuff, and they'll say he's the perfect gentleman. And, the league just had to be thrilled with him. Like, everybody was totally outraged about the draft. And Steve Eiserman comes out and says the truth, which is we knew what the odds were going in. We knew that those teams had better odds than we did of landing first. So, we're not all that surprised. This is kind of what we thought would happen. And, you know, like he could have come out and just, you know, been bitter about it. Remember when Buffalo, you know, didn't win the Connor McDavid sweepstakes and how, you know, Tim Murray just couldn't hide his disappointment. And, you know, just it was just a bad situation. And Eisenman could have made this situation worse, but he chose not to.
Well, I can remember when Steve first took the job with the Wings after he was done playing, and I cover a lot of junior hockey in Windsor in those days. And it was rare that you went to a Spitfires game and he wasn't there scouting and talking to people and learning. And he told me that he would go on every trip to Grand Rapids with Ken Holland and Jim Nill just to sit in the car and listen, to learn, to ask questions. And there's no doubt he puts in the time and he leaves no stone unturned. And he was, you say, he wanted to be an apprentice. He wanted to earn the right to sit in that GM's chair. He didn't want it handed to him. And he's done that. He, you know, whether it's running the Canadian Olympic team or the, you know, the job he did in Tampa Bay, the guy, you can't criticize his work ethic. You can't ever suggest that he doesn't put in the hours. And he was, you know, he didn't ever take anything for granted just because he was Steve Yzerman, that, you know, he was going to move up the ladder and get this shot. And he, as you say, he probably would have because he is Steve Yzerman, but he didn't want the job because he was Steve Yzerman. I'll share a good Lou Lamoriello story because I think you might have misinterpreted. I didn't mean to say suggest that Lou was a bad guy. I think there's a public perception that he's kind of a hard guy to deal with and he's not much fun, but I wrote Marcel Pronovost's biography with him, and Marcel was a scout with the Devils from the early 90s, right through all their Stanley Cup years and right up till the end of his life. And when Marcel was ill and worried about whether he was going to have a job, Lou Lamoriello told him, "You have a job with us for life. You never have to worry about that." And they kept Marcel on the payroll. And I know not just Lou, but David Conte would frequently come to visit Marcel at his home when he was ill. And you talk about a family that the Devils treated their employees. I mean, he was just a scout. You know, that's kind of the bottom rung in the hockey hierarchy in terms of executives. You know, the scouts are the guys who do the legwork, and Marcel was thought of as just as important as anybody else in that organization. And you know, that's the way you should treat your scouts, because they are your pipeline to find your players and to make things happen.
Yeah, that's a great story and really kind of emblematic of the way Lamoriello ran his organization. I think you used the word family, and I think that's the, you know, that's the truth. And you know, I think Yzerman as a manager will be much like he was as a player. Like, you know, he's not a as a captain, even though he's really considered one of the greatest captains in NHL history. It wasn't because of rah-rah speeches, or it was just what he did on the ice. And you know, we all remember in the 2002, you know, playoffs when, you know, the image of when Yzerman would go down on the ice, he needed that stick to use to prop himself, you know, up again. He couldn't just get up because his leg was so bad. You know, Chris Draper has always said, you know, Stevie played on one leg. And that's, the absolute truth. Like, he did play on one leg. And I think that's what, man, and, you know, he had this, and still does, as a matter of fact, he has this real biting, jabbing, ribbing humor style. And it can be a little harsh. It's kind of like almost high schoolish, you know, when, you know, guys can't say anything nice about each other, so they're always sort of jabbing them. And I know when the former Red Wings said that, you know, they knew that it was, you know, in fun. But, you know, one of the players said to me, he says, but down underneath, you know, you wondered if there was a little bit of you know, reality to it. Like, if he was jabbing you about your, you know, and this is not what he said, but say he was jabbing you about his shot, your and everything, and you know, he had a good laugh at it. You know, was he really just having some fun, or was he telling you, you know, you better work on that a little bit? You know, like I said, you know, you sort of underneath it all, you always kind of felt that Yzerman, you kind of use that jabbing humor a little bit to try to motivate, you know, players. But, you know, they never knew, because that's not something he was ever going to, talk about. But anyway, I think he's going to be an effective GM. I don't know how you feel about it, but
he has been in Tampa Bay,
For sure.
You can argue that anybody could win with the Canadian Olympic team, but that's not true because other guys didn't, and they had this level of talent. The first 98, they had Gretzky, they had Shanahan, they had all the players they had, Ray Bourque on that team, and they didn't win a medal. It's the same knock people would use against Scotty Bowman. Look at the teams he had. Well, you still got to get those guys to play, and then sometimes it's harder to get stars to play the way you want them to than it is the regular guys, because the stars usually have a pretty good idea of how they want to play. And if you can get them to buy in, I remember Pat Quinn telling me in 2002 when they won the gold medal. It's not going to work because the other guys are going to follow their lead. And he said all three of those guys bought into it instantly. And he said that was a huge part of why they won the gold medal, because if those guys were willing to just go out, have a quick, fast shift, and get off the ice, then the other guys are absolutely going to do it.
Yeah, you don't want to disappoint Steve Yzerman. Before we go, we've run out of time, and I'll let you close us down. But let me ask you this, because I said this the other day, and someone was surprised when I said this. But I said, well, you weren't listening closely. And I know that, I think Gordie Howe is the greatest hockey player in NHL history. But I'm not so sure that we haven't reached the point in Michigan, just because of time moving on, that I could make an argument right now that even though I think so much of Gordie being the greatest player, that Steve Yzerman right now is the most famous player in Red Wings history to the fans. Because, you got to be my age. You got to be 65, really, to have seen Gordie play. And everybody under that saw Yzerman, And, they continued to see him, as a GM. So right now, I guess I wouldn't say that he's the most famous. I guess the better thing is that Yzerman may be more popular right now than Gordie Howe, simply because more people saw him play and we continued to see him perform. He is just, it's hard to describe how big he is in Detroit.
Yeah, and I think the fact that he was their leader when they finally won the Stanley Cup again after all those 42 games without one. People, as you say, there's a lot of people that don't ever remember seeing Gordie Howe play again. And there was a whole generation, maybe two generations, of Wings fans that grew up without seeing them win the Stanley Cup. So when Yzerman led them to that Stanley Cup, he could have pretty much done whatever he wanted in the city after that. I think that's a huge part of it. When you're the guy that leads them, as little as Mark Messier played with the Rangers, when you take in the compass his whole career, he was the guy that finally led them to the cup, and he's revered in New York for that, and he always will be. So that's a huge part of why I think Yzerman is so beloved, because he ended a long drought that had frustrated Red Wings fans for almost half a century.
Yeah, and I think Messier is the guy that I would put up as the guy that, if you're talking about the greatest captains in NHL history, I think Messier is up there with Yzerman as well.
Well, I'm going to be the captain right now and say it's time to go. And we've had another great discussion. Appreciate Ansar joining us. And we'll be back with you on Tuesday with another guest and hopefully just as equally of stimulating conversation. Everybody have a great day.